trees and walnut trees are called pinnate. Pinna means feather. They're like, they're leaves with side, the whole thing is a leaf but it has side leaves. And if it's got side leaves with one, side leaves on those, it's called bipinnate. And if it's got side leaves with side leaves with side leaves, it's called tripinnate. So this is a tripinnate leaf. And of course, you know that ferns characteristically develop with this folded up, and they unfold. Mm. And so you can see these beautiful shoots unfolding here. Mm. And it's astonishing the way the whole of this complex structure develops in a tiny form, all folded up, and then as it develops, it unfolds and unrolls the structure. And this is true of all ferns, this pattern of growth. And some ferns, some are bipinnate, there are other ferns around Esalen which are bipinnate, but this is a good example of the fractile tripinnate structure.
What makes these a leaf as opposed to a branch?
Well, the fact that it's got a leaf stalk, it has got a sort of trunk, because it's a tree fern. Okay. But what makes it a leaf on a walnut tree, for example, is that there's a thing, when the leaf drops off in autumn, there's a thing at the bottom of the leaf, where it comes out of the shoot as a whole. Okay. And there's a difference between a leaf stalk and a branch. And it's to do with the fact that the leaf has a little bud where it comes off the plant, where the leaflets don't. It's a slightly technical distinction, but there is a real difference between the leaf and the leaflet, which is part of the leaf.
So there must be a function for the try and the buy.
Well, who knows? I mean, every time people try to think of functions for leaves, I mean, if you try a kind of utilitarian Darwinian argument for leaf shapes, you say, oh, well, this leaf has some function because it has more exposure to light with less use of material, or sometimes they have points where water can drip off the tip and stuff. But then you look and growing right next to it is a plant that's functioning just as well, like these. They're growing just as well, and they're totally different. So any attempt to come up with functional arguments for leaves, you go to a tropical forest or a temperate forest or any forest, you'll find all these trees side by side with completely different leaves, and they all seem to work.
So what's
it? It doesn't matter.
Well, I mean, seem to be lots of leaves seem to be functioning perfectly well, but any attempt to explain it all in terms of a functional argument fails over and over again in botany.
Is there another type of argument?
For why?
There's no real argument for diversity in plants. I mean, there's some botanists have just given up trying to say it all has to have a functional... Natural selection means anything that doesn't work will die out. Uh-huh. That's basically what it tells us. Mm-hmm. It's got to function reasonably well, otherwise it won't survive. Mm-hmm. But lots of different things function more or less equally well. And they don't all die out. And tropical forests can have hundreds of species of trees per acre.
So diversity itself might be its function.
Diversity drives evolution.
Or beauty and love
beauty,
and intelligence.
Variety, difference.
Yes.
Like art, you know, what's
that
the function?
That might be its purpose. Mm.
So any attempt to have a completely strictly utilitarian explanation fails over and over again. What we'll do now is step into the redwood grove through the danger gate. And we'll cross a bridge. Be careful on the bridge, you can fall in to a rushing stream. Right, we'll stop here.
Okay.
So
that
just this. Rupert, how old are these trees, do you think?
I would guess about at least 150 years.
150?
Maybe more, but I just don't know.
Well, what's the oldest tree that we know of that exists?
I think about 5,000
5,000, okay.
Is it a redwood?
I think sequoias are about 3,000.
Well, redwoods, bristle-toed pines are the oldest.
Uh-huh.
Yes. Okay, well, talking of the book coming to this redwood grove, which is beautiful grove, and a lot of people who visit Western don't come in here, they're put off by the danger zone. There is a trail that goes up along the street, which I enjoy walking on myself. I wanted to make two basic points here. The first is one that's completely obvious, and it's so obvious we easily forget it. And that is that trees, like us, are living in the Earth's gravitational field, and they're responding to the Earth's gravitational field. So if we look across there at those trees, you see they're growing straight up. They're not coming out of the bank at right angles to the bank. They're growing straight up in relation to gravity. And they can actually feel the gravitational field. And plant physiologists have worked it out. They have starch grains inside them, and the starch grains roll to the bottom of the cell, and it tells the plant where gravity is. So they sense the gravitational field. But the interesting thing is, you see that the main shoot grows straight up, but the side branches, which also feel the gravitational field, mm-hmm. don't grow straight up, they grow at right angles.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not as if it's a completely mechanical thing, it always grows straight up.
Mm-hmm.
All these side branches you can see the dead ones sticking out, they stick out at right angles.
Mm-hmm.
But the plant has a kind of, it has a morphogenetic field, a field that's like an invisible mold for the whole plant. And if you destroy the leading shoot, the one that's growing straight up, then one of the side branches will start growing up instead. And we see an example just across there. There's a tree that where the leading shoot was killed, it's dead. You can see a side branch.
Wow.
It grows straight up. And so we've got basically a trunk growing out of the side.
Why
branch.
Is that?
It's the nature of the plant is to have a leading shoot that grows up, and
okay.
if the side branches,
mm-hmm.
you know, if you lose the leading shoot, then one of the side branches takes over. It's a form of regeneration.
Did you say in the nature?
Very interesting. No, I said if the side branches, it takes over, then it's a form of regeneration. It regenerates.
Mm-hmm.
Like when we heal from wounds, the tree heals from wounds by another branch taking over.
Mm-hmm.
Here's
and
another
what it
one.
Shows it's not just, there are quite a few examples here where you've got side branches growing straight up, whereas the majority of them grow sideways. It's not exactly a genetic programming, the genes are the same in every cell in the tree.
Yeah.
The program's the same, but the tree's responding as a whole.
That would be the morphogenetic field.
Yes, the morphogenetic field.
Yeah.
That would be my way of describing it. But what we can actually see, you know, whatever you, however you explain it, what you can see is the plant has a tendency, if you stop the main shoot growing straight up, then a side branch takes over and grows up instead. A second point I want to make here is that with some conifers, like redwoods and Douglas firs, there's a very strong upward tendency. The main growth is of a single trunk that grows straight up. And you get side branches, but basically you've got one trunk. Now some other conifers, like the Monterey cypress, are much more branched, and the tree form is completely different. And that again is to do with the field of the plant, the tendency of the plant as a whole. And with deciduous trees, some have a very strong upward tendency, but most deciduous trees are much more branched. It's only among certain conifers that you get this really, really strong upward growth pattern. And we see it very clearly with these redwoods. As we walk up the hill in a moment, just before the laundry at the top of the hill, we pass a magnificent Monterey cypress, and which is very branched and shows a completely different growth form from these redwoods. And those of you who live in California will probably know this, but the Monterey cypress, Cupressus macrocarpus, was confined until 100 years ago to two small relic groves. People thought it was extinct, but they found two small groves, one at Pebble Beach and the other at Point Lobos, or Lobos. And then people planted them along the coast, and then they seeded. And there's lots of them here at Esalen, but they haven't always been here. They've only been here for about 100 years at most. But these redwoods have always been here, and they are a magnificent tree. Unlike most conifers, when you cut them down, they send out new shoots and regenerate new trees. The vast majority of conifers, when you cut them down, that's it. They're dead, but not redwoods. And when you look at places where redwoods have been logged, then you'll see these clusters, often circles of them, growing round an old stump.
How long will it take a redwood to grow like these?
150 years.
I think some of the bigger ones are probably about 150.
Okay.
I don't know. I haven't, you know, I don't know the tree rings on these plants, but they can last for 1,000 years or more. Good light. So this is an example of a Monterey cypress. And you see how completely different in growth form it is from a redwood. Very much more branched.
Looks like a tamarind tree almost.
Yes, it does. It looks more like a deciduous tree, many of which are highly branched.
Yeah.
I mean, some of them grow straight up. There's one over there that's fairly straight up, like a bit like a redwood. But again, they vary tremendously depending on what's happened in their history, whether they've been injured, whether they get light or shade. So now what we're doing is entering the garden. Those of you who've got lenses, this is your chance to look at flowers of different kinds. And don't forget, hold it up to your eye and go in and zoom in and out of the flower to get this bee's eye view. So you get this kind of wraparound effect. The ones that are best to do this with are the ones which are like the foxglove, have kind of tubes. But also look at the daisy-type flowers, and you'll see all the little flowers inside the flower. You'll have the lens for the next 10 minutes. Then you give them to people who haven't got the lens. Those who haven't got the lens can come with me, and we'll be looking at leaves and scented geraniums as we move through the garden. So those who've got lenses, start off and you can go on the main path and the side paths. I just have to remind you that tomorrow morning we start at 9:30, not 10, and everyone has to have their luggage out of their rooms by 9:30. Because they have a rapid turnaround in Esalen. They have to clean all the cabins because new people come in the afternoon. So anyway, that's the Esalen instructions.
You just let it come through. And so it's not from Botswana, it's from the land that's here. So